This is a genuine MicroSwiss CR10 heatsink. And at the time of recording, this particular one is the only example that has ever been sent to a customer in the world. Now on the surface, it doesn't look any different than your typical CR10 heatsink that you get from MicroSwiss. But if we zoom in a bit here, you're going to find one very different thing about it. Instead of using a plastic Bowden collect to retain a Bowden tube, it has M10 threads. But why, I hear you asking, are you using M10 threads instead of using the traditional Bowden collect you find in every MicroSwiss heatsink ever? Well, it's simple. Bowden collects are garbage. They fail so quickly. Within like 200 hours, you're replacing them over and over and over. And using a pneumatic coupler ain't any better. In fact, it's probably worse. So then, pray tell, you may ask, what is the point of having this custom one-off heatsink that MicroSwiss has only ever made one of, because I contacted them and requested them to make a heatsink to my specifications? Well, the answer is this. This little doodad right here is what's known as a compression fitting, and although it's not very ubiquitous in the 3D printing industry, it's very well known in the plumbing industry. You may have actually used these on water lines to your refrigerator, for instance. However, I've discovered that when you get the threads and size correct for 3D printing applications, they work incredibly well. Now, the reason why I like these is very simple. It holds the Bowden tube really, really good. I'm talking just about hand tight. It takes a lot of force to pull it out, and that's just hand tight. And the beauty of these things is that they're dirt cheap. You can get 5 of these things on AliExpress for like $4 with shipping. So they end up costing less than a pneumatic coupler, and they're right around the price range of a typical Bowden collect. But these grip super, super hard. So that is why I asked MicroSwiss, hey, if I paid you guys, would you make me a custom heatsink real quick? And we went back and forth with some emails and some design discussion, and eventually they said, yeah, we could do that for you. So this compression fitting screws very nicely into this heatsink. And the beauty of it is, this heatsink was not modified by me. Everything about it comes directly from MicroSwiss, which is fantastic. Just a quick recap for those of you who are unfamiliar with compression fittings, they work like this. You take the compression nut, slide it over the Bowden tube, then you take this tiny little brass sleeve and you slide that over the Bowden tube. Then you take those, slide your Bowden tube into your heatsink, take your compression nut, spin it on down, make sure it's nice and tight, get even hand tight. That is wickedly strong. And the beauty of this is, you might think to yourself, compression fitting, isn't that going to squish the tube and make the internal diameter of the Bowden tube a bit restrictive? And the answer is no, actually. I get what you're coming from, though, because if you take any tube and you apply pressure to it, you're just going to kink it off like any garden hose. You go from this and then you go to, well, that's going to restrict. But here's the thing. That brass compression ring covers the entire Bowden tube all the way around, all 360 degrees. So when it compresses, it has even force going down around the tube. So it's not actually compressing the tube in a way that suddenly changes the internal diameter. What it's actually doing is taking that brass compression ring and fitting it so that it fits around the outer diameter of the Bowden tube very snugly, and that is what holds it in place. And I know it doesn't restrict the filament because I have been using these brass compression fittings on my extruder for the past month. I have an all-metal BMG, which you're going to see in a moment, and it's been working flawlessly. So that is what drove me to want to have this made, because I think we may have finally found a solution to the Bowden tube problems we all face. This is my Ender 3 Pro, and pretty much nothing about it is stock anymore. In fact, the only thing that is stock is probably the frame. But the MicroSwiss heatsink is the classic type that you're going to find on their store. And we're going to take a look at that, and we're going to disassemble it here. So, first off, we're going to remove my little fan duct. We're going to talk about that Bowden Collect real quick, because that is, in fact, why we are going through all of this in the first place, right? So, that right there. Okay. So this is a Bowden Collect. It's a plastic piece that inserts into the heatsink, and then it's got four metal teeth that grip onto the Bowden tube, and if you can retain it well enough, then it will be good for a little while. But I do a lot of printing all the time, and one of the first things to fail is always the Bowden Collect or a pneumatic coupler. So in the quest for consistent performance and the least amount of maintenance, we have come to this point where this heatsink is going to be removed, and everything else is also a genuine MicroSwiss product on this hot end. So should be quite interesting to see how it happens. All right, so we've got both heat sinks side by side, the new one on the left, the old one on the right. As you can see, they are identical in every way except for the top. So this is where we would screw in our compression fitting. And here is the hole that you would put your Bowden Collect in. So ye old Bowden Collect just pops into here with a wee bit of force, and you've got to make sure you get it in there right. And then we've got the M10 threads, which much easier to put together and then disassemble if you have any maintenance reasons. So now here's something that I want to show everyone, because I know this was a concern with a lot of people when I originally talked about this. So this is some plastic coming out of the Bowden tube, and the Bowden tube has the compression ring around it. It is nice and compressed. And this is a genuine Capricorn Bowden tube, so the internal diameter tolerances are very tight. But even with that, filament comes out easy enough. So if I move my extruder a little bit, see, it's going through nice and easy here. Nothing a BMG cannot handle. You also got to remember, PTFE is very slippery. It's got very low friction, so it doesn't appear that it's actually getting caught on anything. Okie doke, the compression fitting is on, and we don't just have a compression fitting on the heatsink. No, no. We've got one on the extruder as well, back there. That's my Fisatec all-metal BMG extruder. So, let's extrude some plastic, shall we? There we go. That seems to be coming out nice enough. So we can get a better shot of everything going on here. I'm just extruding 10 millimeters at a time, making sure everything goes good. It's coming out beautifully out of my MicroSwiss M2 hardened steel nozzle, which I'm just saying that because I like the nozzle. It's been very reliable for me. But I think we are ready to start a benchy. Okie doke. So we've got the first layer going on our 3D benchy. And this is going to take maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours, something like that, according to Kira. But everything seems to be going down okay. First layer is kind of really dependent on how flat and level your bed is and your Z-axis offset. I do have an auto bed leveler, but I've been experimenting with a few solid bed mounts. So if the first layer is a little wonky, that is probably my bad. But, you know, it appears to be... Ooh, zoomed in a little too far there. It appears to be going rather well, actually. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a finished benchy. Now, admittedly, looking at the benchy, there is a lot that I could personally do in terms of tweaking my settings in Cura to make this look a lot nicer. This is white filament, so it really is good at making every little blemish and artifact very noticeable. But that being said, software optimizations aside, it came out pretty good. So yeah, there's some zits on there that can be dealt with, some seams that could be probably optimized. But what I really wanted to look at is the retractions. So looking at that, you could probably see up at the top, and I actually did a live stream of this entire benchy being made. So if you want to check out my videos and see what it was doing at any particular point, you can definitely do that. But my overhangs admittedly aren't as good as some people's because I need to print a better fan duct. I've been meaning to put one on, but it did the job for the time being. But a little bit of stringing, but this is Hatchbox filament. Hatchbox stuff is just super gooey in general. So getting all that set up, it takes a little while. But the fact that everything turned out pretty good at the end of the day, and yes, that pretty good is subjective to the settings and the machine. Yes, I know. I'm just preparing for the onslaught of comments of how I can optimize my benchy. But I actually optimized my printer for something completely different. Something that I print all the time for a production model that I have made. But benchies are fun to do nevertheless. So, this is the benchy. Is it the best benchy? Well, no, of course not. Kidding? I'm actually doing some optimizations as we speak with the whole setup because I've been having some fun trying to tune some other stuff like linear advance. And I'm also, you know, determining feed rate or, no, not the feed rate, I'm sorry, the jerk speed, stuff like that. And, you know, that's a whole process. It's going to take a little while. So the point is, the couplers, the couplers work really well. I've been printing for the last, gosh, like 10 hours now, and I haven't had any problems in terms of feeding filament. Retractions are not an issue. Feeding filament is not an issue. These couplers work. They do. And they work perfectly well on this heatsink. So I think the proof of concept is there. Now then, if we could get more people to really test this out and get a good data set, a good sample size, I think this might be, if you're using a Bowden setup like I am, the best route to go down if you're trying to secure that Bowden tube. So, yeah. There's definitely things I need to optimize, but it's definitely a thing, and it's definitely something I can optimize. So, thanks for watching, guys. If you're interested in these things, maybe leave a comment down below. Who knows? Perhaps MicroSwiss might stumble upon this video, and if they see there's a lot of public interest, you never know.